This podcast is sponsored by Murgatroyd, intellectual property attorneys. For more information on today's guest and our company, visit murgatroyd.com/podcasts.
Hello and welcome to the fifth season of Murgatroyd's Innovation Talks podcasts. We're delighted you have joined us. If you have any questions, you can email us at innovation.talks@murgatroyd.com or contact us via Twitter at Murgatroyd. And please remember to subscribe so you don't miss any future episodes. So let's go straight into today's podcast.
Good morning. I'm Chris Finn, Director of Trademarks, Murgatroyd's Glasgow office, and I'm delighted today to be joined by Steve Wayne from our Croydon office.
Hi there, Chris. How are you?
Fine. Enjoying lockdown, I'm sure.
Yes, most definitely. To introduce myself, I'm Steve Wayne. I'm a Director of Trademarks in the Croydon office at Murgatroyd & Company. I deal with trademarks with respect to the fashion industry and many other type of businesses who face problems with respect to online infringement and counterfeiting of their products.
Yep, I think you're probably more expert on this than I am. I also deal in trademarks, but my practice is primarily in the Scotch whiskies and drinks industries and the like. We identify a lot of applications outside of the UK. But yes, certainly counterfeiting is coming more to their attention. And one of my clients is actually now looking at what steps they can take to actually put more of a structure in place to keep an eye on counterfeits and manage them. So,
well, basically, like I say, I do a lot of work for the fashion industry, and obviously it's very simple to counterfeit a fashion item, a t-shirt, a pair of jeans, very cheap, and the profit margins are huge. What I advise my clients is basic awareness, and that word works so well with respect to everything that they have to do to protect their trademarks online. So I'll quickly go through what I feel the key points are with respect to combating online counterfeiting. Awareness means brand awareness. It means that you have to be aware of exactly what your trademarks are. Why do people buy your products? So you have to identify the trademarks. You have to identify not just the words that you use to identify your products, but also the logos, the color schemes, the designs. So you have to yourself be aware of what it is that other people could copy. Awareness also extends to, are you protected? Do you know what you actually have protected? Are you aware of the gaps in your protection? You need to know what trademarks are most important to you, because you then need to go and make sure that you have a strong IP portfolio of trademarks, designs, and even patents if your product is patentable, to ensure that you are protected and can take action against online counterfeiting and counterfeiting in the offline world as well.
So do you think that it's necessary to have protection for your trademarks and patents all over the world? Or is it just certain jurisdictions that you need to be looking at?
I mean, I think, again, that comes to awareness. You have to be aware of where your major markets are, because, you know, obtaining IP protection isn't the cheapest thing in the world to do, but it is very necessary. So you have to make sure that you're using your resources, be that money or time, to protect those areas that are most important. So if you sell 80% of your products in the UK and Europe, and you sell 3 units in Japan, it's probably not worth worrying about Japan. If someone is counterfeiting you there, it's not nice, you don't want it to happen, but the costs of protecting your mark and enforcing that mark in regards to the return on selling 3 units means that it's almost certainly not worthwhile. But it's still important in that case that you keep an eye worldwide with respect to counterfeits, because, of course, those counterfeits can come into the territories that you are interested in.
So tell me, can you rely on the fact that you've just been using a mark in a foreign country to enforce your rights? Is that sufficient, or do you have to have a registration?
You don't have to have a registration in a lot of territories. In a lot of territories, you can obtain rights through use. There are various terms for it. There are various common law rights. In the UK, you have the common law tort of passing off. But with respect to almost all of these different types of protection, what you actually have to do is you have to prove your use of the mark. You have to prove that you have a reputation in the United Kingdom. In the United Kingdom, you also have to prove that you would be damaged. If you were to obtain statutory trademark protection, it's much easier. You literally are given a piece of paper, a registration certificate, and that says that you have the monopoly on that trademark. So although you can protect your mark simply through user rights, it tends to be an awful lot more expensive. It tends to be a lot more difficult, And you even have to spend a lot more time on it because you will have to obtain the evidence of your reputation. You will have to produce lots and lots of evidence and information. You will have to approach third parties to provide you with evidence to say that you are a well-known brand. Again, if you obtain statutory trademark protection, you have a piece of paper that says it's your trademark.
Right. So you're saying that I can't then just rely upon the trademark registry to enforce my rights for me?
No. Basically, you are responsible. And again, this keys into the awareness. It brings up the next point with respect to awareness. You have to make sure that not only yourself, but all your employees, your associated companies, your suppliers, your distributors, and even your customers are aware of what your brand is, of what your trademark is, and also aware that there might be counterfeit products out there and that they should be careful and make sure that what they are buying is not a counterfeit product. And if it's your employees, that they keep their eyes out for a counterfeit product. And more important than that, and it's something I stress to all my clients, someone in the company has to be responsible for collating all that information. If a customer writes to you and says, I've bought your product and it was a load of rubbish, and you know that you did not sell that product, it's not good enough for one person to know that and another person to know that a supplier is complaining that there's other products on the marketplace using the same name. The same person needs to know because it's probably, or potentially at least, the same company who is producing those counterfeit products further up the line. And you need to be able to take action against that company with respect to everything they're doing. So in order to prevent counterfeiting, there are various steps that you can take. But the first thing is actually being aware of the counterfeiting. So you need that reporting system in place. There are also ways that you can actually take a more proactive step. There are companies who will actually monitor online marketplaces like Amazon and eBay, and they will provide you with information with respect to counterfeit products which they find. You can also take a look at your own balance books. If you are not making sales that you would expect to make, if you have a dramatic drop off in sales, it's probably because there's a counterfeit product out there, which is being sold for cheaper than your product. And therefore, there are people who don't care that it's counterfeit or don't know that it's counterfeit, and they are buying that product and basically hurting your bottom line.
So how would a member of the public know whether something is counterfeit to real? Because obviously these days, it's quite easy for people to come up with very close facsimiles to originals and very good artwork and the like. So what can you do to actually make sure that you can tell the difference between a real original and a counterfeit?
Basically, it starts off with having good brand control. So if you have a certain color related to your product, for example, you always use the same color. And I don't just mean the same, you know, blue. You use the same shade of blue, the same Pantone. You make sure that if you have third-party suppliers or, you know, people who manufacture your products for you, that they are producing exactly the same product. Because even though it is easier than ever nowadays to counterfeit a product, it's not always easy to get it exactly right. I do work for a few fashion lines, and we will be sent stuff from customs and excise, which they ask if it's fake. And we can tell immediately simply because it has the name slapped on the handbag, whatever it might be. But it also has a pattern on it that our client has never used, would never use, because they have a specific pattern that they use, much like the Louis Vuitton pattern. It's very important that you have a set brand, a set look, everything like that. And you only deviate from it if you are actually launching a new look, a new design. And what you do is you educate your customers with respect to that. So if you are Levi's jeans, you educate your customers that they should see the little badge on the back. They should see the little red tag. They are important with respect to marketing because your customers will know that that's genuine. But it will also educate your customers to look out for those small differences that might show them that it's not a counterfeit product. But you should also be aware that a lot of ways that you will find out about counterfeit products is actually customers writing to you to complain about your product because they don't realize it's counterfeit. And you have to understand that that will happen. And all you can do in that situation is obviously explain to the customer the situation. But you also therefore have to log that and make sure that you take action against it.
Right. So what sort of action is open to you under anti-counterfeiting, especially online? What steps can you take to actually stop? You know, it sounds a bit like you may have a whack-a-mole situation trying to stop people online.
It certainly is. I mean, I think you have to go into it with the knowledge and expectation that you will not be able to stop every example simply because they will pop up again. However, that doesn't mean you should just give up. Every time you stop something, you are protecting your brand, you are protecting your bottom line, and you are doing damage, because a lot of counterfeiting, although it seems to come from different places, is actually part of organized crime. And the further up the chain, it is actually the same bodies who are responsible for counterfeiting these products. So there are numerous steps that you can take, and it very much depends upon the situation. The easiest way to take any action, first of all, is with respect to online marketplaces, eBay, Amazon. I believe that the statistics say that 80% of online counterfeiting actually comes through the top 10 marketplaces on the internet. So if you can establish a relation with those companies and be very aware of what you can do with respect to counterfeiting on those platforms, you can save yourself a lot of time and money. You can make a complaint to Amazon. You can make a complaint to eBay. You can make a complaint to Facebook with respect to this is a counterfeit product. You have to make sure that you have everything in place to make that complaint. So if you have a trademark registration, you have to be able to, you know, be aware of what your trademark registration is and what it covers. But a very simple process in most cases, you literally fill in a form on Amazon and send it off to them. And they tend to follow the trademark owner. They tend to agree with the trademark owner. I've actually had it from the other side, where a client of mine wasn't producing counterfeit products, but was in dispute with the trademark owner over something else. And Amazon actually agreed with the trademark owner in that case. And it was a nice little fight that we had with Amazon. But they are very, very aware that despite various cases around the world going one way or another, they are always open to being accused of facilitating the selling of counterfeit products. So they will normally side with the trademark owner. With respect to other courses of action you can take, it differs from country to country. Using the UK as an example, you can become very good friends with your local trading standards officer. Trading standards will coordinate with the police on your behalf. They will take action themselves. They will seize in raids any counterfeit products which they can find. You can also establish a relationship with customs and excise. You can actually have a customs notice with respect to your trademarks in many European countries. And what will happen is that customs and excise, if they find a shipment of products bearing that trademark, which they believe to be suspect, will seize it and will write to you and say, is this genuine? If you establish those good relationships, I have a client who I probably once a week receive an email from Trading Standards somewhere in the country saying, we think this is counterfeit products. Do you agree? There are various options to take. However, you have to be aware that in each of those options, you are relying on somebody else to do your work for you. You're relying on the online marketplace. You're relying on Trading Standards. You're relying on the police. You're relying on customs and excise. In most cases, if it's a clear case of trademark infringement and counterfeiting, they will act. But if they don't feel that they can act, if they don't feel it's a worthwhile use of their resources because they found one bag, whatever, you can actually look to take a civil action against them on the basis of trademark infringement if you have that registration that we discussed earlier.
It certainly sounds like there's a lot of time and effort going to be involved in actually policing this. So how does one go about actually streamlining that? Because obviously if counterfeiting is a big problem and you're going to be losing profits by non-genuine products being sold, possible damage to your reputation, there's got to be some way of managing that. So what's the best way to manage this problem? How does one proactively make sure that you're spending the best time and effort, the best amount of time and effort on actually getting the best bang for the buck and policing counterfeiting?
I think we go back to that term awareness again. It's a nice little catchphrase. It's a nice little term to use because it works in so many levels with respect to this. I think you start in the right place with the awareness of your brands and you obtain that trademark protection. Then you make sure that everyone is aware that they should be telling you about problems. They should be telling you about counterfeit products. And then you have a person, a team, however big your business is, to coordinate that. What you then do is you get onside a useful, helpful, friendly neighborhood trademark attorney who can basically help you coordinate any actions which you may need to take against third parties. You really just need to centralize everything, because what you will find is, although setting it up will probably be a good amount of resources and time that has to be put in, then after that's done, it's actually quite simple because it's the same evidence, it's the same registration, it's the same contacts that you need to make. You basically fill in the same forms. It's actually about having a system in place. And if you have that system in place, then you will not have to spend too much time actually taking action and filling in forms and all that, because you will have had made those contacts. This is where your trademark attorney can become very useful. I act on behalf of my clients with respect to all trading standards inquiries. And in most cases, trading standards actually come to myself as the representative recorded before the UK Trademarks Registry. If you have decided with your attorney what actions you want to take, the attorney can then just deal with it on your behalf. And he might send you something to sign. He might say, oh, I need an affidavit saying that this is not genuine. But you will not be spending an awful lot of time with respect to taking action because your attorney will be coordinating that. Your attorney can also, in that regard, actually carry out regular reviews for you with respect to the protection you have, which is something that is incredibly important. If you have a trademark portfolio, that doesn't mean it's done. You don't have to worry about it again, because you might not remember that you don't have a registration in Japan because you only sold 3 units, but suddenly a Japanese movie star wore one of your products and suddenly you sell 1 million units a year and you haven't got a trademark registration. So it's very important that you have that relationship with your attorney and that he, on your behalf, can take action, but also can recommend further action that you may need to take. For example, we've had a few things come in from customs about products coming from Japan, and then you realize you don't have protection in Japan. Or even more proactively, and it's something I do for several of my clients, every 6 months, they literally send me a list of what they're doing. And I write back and go, you don't need that registration in Australia anymore because you've said you're never going there again, but you do need a new registration in Japan. So that attorney-client relationship really needs to be built up, and it's all for your benefit because you will be doing an awful lot less work.
Sure. Other services available that you could actually set up so that somebody will notify you proactively of a similar mark being filed or somebody else using the similar marks? Because certainly what you've mentioned up to now has been sort of, you know, relying on people telling you, relying on customers telling you. But what can clients put in place that will actually notify them proactively that there's something out there so they need to take action?
Okay.
What sort of things are available?
First of all, with respect to your actual registered trademarks, making sure that no one tries to register a trademark that is similar or identical to yours, especially in a country where you might not have protection because you don't have a huge market. There is a trademark watching service which your trademark attorney can put in place, and that will basically identify trademarks which are being filed, and you can have it on a country basis, an area basis, or a worldwide basis. Trademarks that are actually filed in countries which are considered similar to yours. Very handy with respect to countries such as China, where I am constantly filing oppositions on the basis of my clients' marks because somebody has filed a very, very similar, or in one case, identical trademark. It's very important that you keep an eye on what people are trying to register. With respect to actual use online, counterfeit products being sold online, there are various companies who offer online watching services. It's something that your trademark attorney can coordinate, and they basically do just scour the web, especially those top 10 marketplaces that account for most counterfeit products, and basically will let you know of any new listings. Because in most cases, you will have a listing on Amazon, for example, and you may sell yourselves directly on Amazon, but another listing will pop up and the firm will know that it's not yours because it's not coming from your official Amazon account. So that's something that can be put in place. There are industry bodies that you can join who can help out, the anti-counterfeiting group being one. They can provide you with advice, but there are other local initiatives. I'm aware of one in Manchester that is done by Manchester County Council on Trading Standards and the Manchester Police. But again, this is something that your attorney should be able to advise you on with respect to what is best for you, because it is a tailored approach. If you are a company who sells products mainly through your own website, then you're probably going to need a different type of protection than somebody who actively markets on social media, on marketplaces. So it's something that you really need to go through with your trademark attorney.
Okay. A few more questions before we wrap up. One, what's the difference for clients between infringement and counterfeiting? Are they two sides of the same coin, or are they related? How do they interlink?
I mean, they're very much two sides of the same coin as it comes to the effect it has on a client. You can infringe a trademark by not actually copying that trademark completely. So if you have a similar trademark, that would be an infringement. It would not be a counterfeit product. Counterfeit product is something that is deliberately manufactured to look and be basically a genuine product. You are trying to make someone buy that thinking that they are buying a genuine product. An infringing product could use a different name, have a slightly different look. And what you're doing in that case is you're trying to offer an alternative that's just as good. You're trying to almost trick the consumer into thinking, well, I'm not going to pay the full price for the real thing, but that's just as good. You know, it's just as good. But to a company, it has the same effect. It damages the reputation because people can be confused by an infringing product, even if it doesn't look exactly the same like a counterfeit product tends to. It can still be considered to be the same. It might be considered a variation, and it can damage your reputation. And of course, it can damage your bottom line. It can damage your sales because people, if provided with a much cheaper alternative that's kind of similar, will go ahead and purchase that. So what you have is you have a lot of copycat perfumes, for example. So they're not actually counterfeit. They are not Givenchy perfume, but they are slightly different. The packaging is slightly different. The name is slightly different, but it still has that cachet of being a Givenchy perfume. So even though they're not directly copying you, what they're doing is taking business away from you.
Because a lot of what happens now is online, especially social media, Facebook and other platforms. How do you differentiate between people who are genuinely trying to rip you off and people who are just big fans of you? You know, they want to produce a t-shirt which has got your logo on it because they love your product. You know, how do you deal with those?
Yeah. It's a very difficult one, but you do have to consider them to be the same, because although they may be producing something as an homage, as they may, like you say, be big fans, and it's something that you see with respect to bands and, well, famous people, celebrities, people might be doing it purely as a way of saying, I love this person. But if they are producing it and selling it, then the people buying from them may not know that it's not an official product. People who see it in the street may not know that it's not an official product. It can still cause damage to your reputation, because once it's in the marketplace, the original intention is completely lost, and it suddenly is just another counterfeit product, another infringing product. So if they come back and say, I'm a huge fan, maybe you go, thank you very much, but please don't do that again. And here's a £10 off voucher, or here's a free t-shirt or something like that. But it's better to lose one fan than damage your trademark, damage your brand, to basically allow someone to do that.
I mean, the reason I asked this question, because I'm aware that a lot of companies can suffer serious reputational damage by being seen to be coming on hard on the little man. You know, and because everything's now viral, everything's now on, you know, can spread so quickly, that can quickly escalate and actually rebound. You know, here's a big nasty lawyer's letter I got for just doing something which I was a big fan, and instead I'm getting the threats of legal action and millions of pounds and what, you know. So how does one manage that side of things?
I mean, I do understand that completely, and it's something that we come up against a lot with respect to certain clients. I do think that sometimes you have to consider that a reputational hit might be worthwhile with respect to preventing something happening. I think a lot of it is common sense. As an attorney, I will identify who the person is who's doing this. If it is one person who lives in a flat in Northampton, I'm probably not actually going to go in as heavily as if it's a direct competitor of ours. If it's someone that has been identified as selling 5,000 units of a fake product, they're not doing it because they're a fan. They're doing it because they're a criminal. So there is a common sense element. If you find that someone is tie-dyeing your logo onto T-shirts and selling them for £5 and they've sold 23 of them, then don't go in as heavily. But again, there is a question of damage to your reputation, obviously, if you are made out to be the bad guy. But that has to be balanced with the damage to your reputation. If people start thinking your product is low quality, or even if your product, if it's known as a sought after brand, because it is not cheap and it's very high quality. That reputation is damaged if the marketplace is flooded with fake replicas and fake counterfeits. So you basically do have to consider what's more important, your public image for the next 2 months or your brand identity for the life of that brand.
Well, Steve, thanks very much. It's been actually great talking to you. Thanks very much for that discussion. And
thank you very much, Chris.
Have you got anything you want to summarize this conversation with? An ending about Bonmo to leave?
Certainly. I hate to do it because I'm not a fan of cliches and catchphrases, but one word, awareness. Be aware of everything with respect to your trademarks and what you're doing with them. And you really can't go wrong.
Great. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for your time today. We hope you found today's podcast valuable. And remember to subscribe so you don't miss any of our future episodes. So until the next time, goodbye.
Our business is founded on trust and collaboration. The subjects we choose for our podcasts are topical and informative. We are always looking for suggestions for new topics for discussion, so if there's an area of IP that you're keen to understand better, please drop us a line at innovation.talks@murgatroyd.com.